Welcome in, everybody. It's Kirk McEwen, and I'm joined by Jimmie Haha of Jimmy's Chicken Shack. New CD is out. It's called Seconds, Jimmie. Congratulations. I like
Thanks,
it.
Man.
Seconds with a two up front. You want to tell us about this? And it's not your second CD. A little confused.
Right?
What's going on?
Well, so I always post up pictures of my food after I eat it.
Yes, there's a plate of food on here.
With a fork instead of a stylus.
Yeah.
And so it's a bit of a... You know, multiple meaning. You know, the seconds that kind of tick away in our lives, and two's been my lucky number all my life, or just a number that rules my stuff. So, And then you know, the idea of seconds, like the throwbacks. No, these songs aren't throwbacks, but yeah, just playing with the words.
What took so long between albums? And you were on Elton John's. Listen, I've known you for a long time. I was there when the first one came out. And it started with 10 Times Big for me.
Yep, exactly.
Little band out of Annapolis. How did that turn into Jimmy's Chicken Shack and the record deal with Rocket Records?
So, I mean, you know, 10 Times Big was around for like 5 years. And, you know, obviously that's when I met you. We played all up and down the East Coast. Almost got signed to a label. And then after that, band broke up. Started Jimmy's Chicken Shack a couple years later. And about 3 years later, we signed Elton John's record label, Rocket Records, just from, you know, I mean, we played all over the place and sold a bunch of records.
You were the first band signed to his label. Do I have that right?
We were one of the first bands, not the first act, but, you know, it was a small roster when it first started out. So, you know, and that went through, God, I think it went through three different labels before our first record came out. Yeah, so it went through A&M Associated, and then it turned into PolyGram, and then Universal, and then eventually we were on Island Def Jam Records. So,
how was that whole experience? Did they do you right? Did you tour behind the album? We started talking because I saw your birthday come up in some of the national prep that I get.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, Jimmie Haha had your age, and so I rang you up immediately. You picked up. He's like, hey, I got the new CD. You know, spend some time with it. Let me know what you think. But how did that whole experience go, recording the album and then hitting the road? Because you made a lot of friends. I know Aaron Lewis from Stain became close.
We collaborated on a tune. I mean, we had a blast. You know, the first record came out. We just started touring around. At the time, High was their single, and it was too hard for rock radio in the daytime, which was really funny at the time.
Yeah.
You know, because alternative was the heavy format at that point. So, you know, eventually it started coming around. We were on MTV, and then, you know, when they played videos. And so we toured for, you know, a couple years on that record, and then put out the next record. And then that single was out on an alternative format.
What Do I Do Right?
Yeah, Do Right. So, you know, each record, obviously all of our records sound real different and all of our songs sound different. So we kind of, you know, straddled different formats. And so it was just fun. I mean, recording records, like proper records at that point, you know, I'd been playing for quite a while, and it was cool to, like, you know, realize that there was a goal back then. It was like, get signed to a label, get on MTV. You know, there's a different world now. But back then, it was like, those were kind of those trophies you wanted to hit, or those,
oh, of course,
you know, those beacons you wanted to hit. And, you know, we toured all over the place and just had a blast. And, you know, that was like the crest of the wave. I mean, you remember when that...
1997 was when the first one came out.
Yep.
And
then 99,
right.
Bring Your Own Stereo. And that's when, you know, the whole radio industry, the record industry, it just kind of got flipped up on its head, basically.
Yeah, it did. Let's play one off the new one.
Sure.
Sleeping with the Enemy is the second song on the disc. Hey, what is that? What came to mind with that? Is that something that you collaborated on, or is that something that came straight from you?
It's actually a collaboration between, I mean, the band was getting together for quite a few years, just throwing down ideas, and Jerome, our drummer, has a studio in Baltimore, and him and Island, our guitar player, were throwing down some ideas, and then I would grab them, and then Island and I started arranging this, and we actually worked on the vocals and the lyrics together on this one, which was really fun. So it was a good collaboration, and, you know, the whole idea was that, it was funny. My wife was like, is that song about me sleeping with the enemy? I'm like, oh, that's messed up. I'm like, no, first of all, I'd never be that overt. But I was like, no, I'm the enemy. I'm sleeping with the enemy. I'm my own worst enemy. Yeah. So that's kind of the idea of the tune, really, I think, overall.
That's great. It's Jimmie Haha and Jimmy's Chicken Shack from their CD Seconds. This is Sleeping with the Enemy. You're a vocal coach, or what's going on?
Nope.
Sleeping with the Enemy, Jimmy's Chicken Shack, the new one off Seconds with a two up front, because it's Jimmy's. lucky number? And will you tour on this? What you were talking to me about, you weren't sure what the singles were going to be.
Yeah,
where are you
know.
Now?
Yeah, we still don't know what the singles will be. You know, I mean, we're doing a tour down to Key West in March, doing a headlining a festival down there, and then doing some shows on the way down and on the way back up. But you know, I mean, I'm open to whatever, man. It's just like whatever. The record dictates. It's not, I mean, it's kind of out. It's not like out on streaming platforms. Mm-hmm. We haven't really pushed it to any radio yet. We're just kind of, you know, still setting things up. And it's funny because people don't realize how long sometimes that stuff you do.
Yeah.
But, you know, we made the record a year and a half ago, you know, and we're still kind of almost putting it out. But it's, you know, if you depending on what your goal is, I mean, people can put out things all the time. You know, you just
throw
stuff up on the Spotify. But, you know, 100,000 songs get uploaded to Spotify every single day.
Is that right?
It's 100,000 a day. So in the 70s, it was 60,000 records were released a year.
Mm-hmm.
Now it literally, are singles. So now it's 100,000 songs a day get uploaded to Spotify. So, you know, we're just trying to kind of not... Do something a little different. We have it out right now. You can get the whole record on Bandcamp,
mm-hmm.
you know. But other than that, we've got we have a video on YouTube that for the first song on the record. But
which we'll hear in a minute.
So you know, the cool thing I think about the record mostly is that it had some depth to it that not just stylistically, but everybody sang on it. And typically, I would do all the backups on our old records. So
really,
I think that it adds this color, you know, to this depth of sound to it when you have other voices, you know.
And so. You mentioned the players, but who are the guys in the band? Jimmy Haha, Get Fiddle and Mouth. Who else?
Right, yeah, so Jerome Mafio has been our drummer for almost 20 years. I mean, this is our 30-year anniversary this year, actually.
Yeah.
But and then Christian Valente plays bass, and he's been with us for, God, 18 years probably.
Mm-hmm.
And then Island Styles plays guitar with us. I think he's been with us for like 11 years maybe.
Is that his real name, Island
Styles? That's his real
Styles.
Island Styles, yeah. And he also plays, he tours and is guitar player for... Candlebox as well.
Mm-hmm.
And then our old guitar player before Island, Matt Jones, played with us, and then he went and played with Cowboy Mouth for quite a few years, but he just recently left them, and I was like, why don't you play with us again? And so now when we play live, he's not on the record, but we're a five piece when we play live now, so it's a lot of fun.
What about the original members on that first album, Jim McD?
Yeah, Jim McD, Che. I just saw Che a couple weeks ago. He's living on a sailboat in Annapolis. Jim Chaney moved back from L.A., so I've hung out with him a couple weeks ago.
Everybody's still okay?
Oh, yeah. I haven't talked to Jim McDonough in a while, but I'm pretty sure he's all right. You know,
okay.
He sat in with us when we did I think it was our 20-year anniversary. He sat in and played some songs when we did a Ramshead Live back in that day.
Chaney and I were going to put together Booty and the Ho Fish. It never got legs, though.
That would have been great.
Hey, Jim Wirt produced.
Yep.
Give us some background on him.
So Jim Wirt, when he first heard our demos for Bring Your Own Stereo, which we did with Steve Wright in Baltimore,
mm-hmm.
He was like, these are the best demos I've ever heard. And he really wanted to do the record. Les Claypool had called me up from Primus. He wanted to produce. I was like, he really liked our first record. I'm like, yeah, it's not going to be like that. It's going to be totally different. So I don't know if you're the right producer. But Jim Wirt was so passionate about our demos. And he had done Incubus Science. He'd done Fiona Apple. He did Brian Setzer Orchestra. He did a lot of wide-ranging stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So we went out to California, recorded with him. It was my favorite time recording a record. Since then, actually, about 6-7 years ago, he did a solo record for me under the name Mend the Hollow.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we were getting ready to do this, I was like, you know, I want these guys to experience a real, you know, musical producer. And Jim was all about it and just like, yeah, come out. And so, I mean, he's done records for Live, for Fuel, for Hoobastank. I mean, he's just done a ton of stuff.
Did you get in the same room or did you record in Maryland and send him the demos? How did that go?
I just sent him demos for this record, and he's got a studio up in Cleveland. So we went up there for 2 weeks, and we had an Airbnb like a block away, and we just walked there every day. I'd get there 3 hours before everybody else. I'd get there at 7, and Jim and I would just start.
Mm-hmm.
Guys would start trickling in around 10, and we'd just hang out all day and record.
You said this album had two separate...
Sides, yeah.
Yeah, explain.
So the album cover has this, you know, mocked up kind of old school record players that we all grew up with, those big cabinets that you slide open and you put your record on.
Console.
Yeah. So, you know, I kind of mocked that art up. But the idea was that to make a record like, when we grew up, you'd get a record, you'd buy a record and you'd open up the album sleeve and you'd read the credits while you had your headphones on in your bedroom and your black light on, your lava lamp, you know. And so I wanted to make kind of that a record, a concept record, in the sense that there was these two different experiences, like you know how Russ Never Sleeps, Neil Young, is acoustic side and electric side. So we did the first five tunes, the first side of the record is more rock and electric, and then the second side is more like acoustic and ethereal. And
yeah, it
is. It goes all over the place. So
very interesting. Tell us about the title track. This is the one you got a video for, right?
Yep. We have a video on our YouTube channel, and it's like a lyric video that I did with a buddy of mine, Joe Carr, who I've written tunes with. We wrote Let's Get Flat on Bring Your Own Stereo. And,
yeah.
But we did it in his garage on a chalkboard, and just did some time-lapse stuff. He had done some really cool time-lapse art, and I was like, let's do a video for seconds, because it really kind of pertains, just doing a time-lapse thing for a song about the seconds that, you know, tick away and slip away from us. And so that's kind of what the song is about, and the record is kind of about life and how, you know, we have these moments and to really, you know, understand that they're each one is a special second, you know, every mm-hmm. single second really counts if you recognize that it does. Sure. You know, so
many of us say, can't wait till next Tuesday.
Yeah, no.
And you forget all of that time in between until you get where you're going.
Yeah, or like people would go, oh, I can't wait for 2022 to be over. I'm like, what's wrong with this? Like, pretty much every day you wake up, it's the best day of your life. So, you know.
Hey, seconds, Jimmy's Chicken Shack. This is the title track to the new one.
Second Slip, yep.
Second Slip, Jimmy's Chicken Shack from Seconds. And that sounds more like something off the first one than anything to me.
Yep.
And it's just a great, when you hear Jimmy's Chicken Shack, you know what you're listening to, you know what I mean?
Right.
And anybody that sees this, my neck hurt today. Oh, I almost canceled on your ass.
I'm glad you did.
But I said, I can't do that because I want to get this out there so people can hear it. How can people pick this up again?
So you can go to Bandcamp and just, you know, Jimmy's Chicken Shack, which is Jimmies. But, yeah, Bandcamp, we have one album up on there. That's it.
Yeah.
And you know, that's the only way we have it out right now. You can obviously listen to the tracks, but you can download the whole record. And then we have one video on our YouTube channel, and it's of Second Slip.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, we're still, like, we did an Indiegogo campaign to crowdfund the record. So I'm just getting CDs out and getting shirts made for other things and trying to fulfill all the people that kind of helped us make the record.
Crowdsourcing, wow.
Yeah, man, it helped, man. It was awesome. We had, I think, about 480 people that donated one way or the other, and it, you know, really helped us pay for everything.
And I saw Brian Bolter's name, who used to work here in a building.
Yeah, he's a good friend of mine.
Hey, are you painting now?
Yeah, I still paint. I paint when I feel like painting. So I owe a lot of paintings right now to people.
Right.
But I won't paint when I'm not feeling it, because I just feel like you don't do good work if you're not feeling it, you know?
It's interesting.
So, yeah, I still paint, and I'm still doing my magazine in Annapolis. And
What's the magazine?
It's called Upstart Annapolis, and it's like a high-quality quarterly kind of coffee table book that's just basically delves into creative people in and around Annapolis that, you know, do all different kinds of stuff, whether it's music, dance, or, you know, writing, television people. I mean, it just kind of runs the gamut of anything that's creative. We're going to kind of cover that, like, basically looking at the people behind those creations. So we never do critiques of restaurants or records. You know, I want to
talk to the people.
Yeah, I want to know what makes people tick, what makes them do what they do. So I think it's a nice magazine. I've been doing it since 2014, and it's fun.
Dude's busy. And how can people, if they want to keep up with the band, is there a website or?
Our website is just a cover page.
All right.
but I mean, the best way is Facebook, Jimmy's Chicken Shack's Facebook, or we have an Instagram, and I pop stuff up on there.
Right.
My manager was like, you have to do a TikTok, and I made one. Once in a while, I throw something up there, but it's just not my,
I hear you. It's not your platform. Well, the album is awesome. You told me to live with it for a while, and I definitely did in my car. And you should too. Everybody, go pick it up at Bandcamp. Jimmy's Chicken Shack. Seconds. Jimmy, thanks for the time. I appreciate it.
I appreciate you, my brother.
Continued success, man.
Yeah, man.
All right, we'll do it again soon.
Yes.